In 1992, production started on the McLaren F1, a lightweight V12 rocket ship that had 627 brake horsepower. It was good for 240 miles an hour and could provide one of the greatest driving experiences of all time. It was, without doubt, a Concord moment. Thing is, though, like said supersonic aircraft, there's never really been anything since. I mean, sure, the Bugatti Veyron was similarly groundbreaking, but it wasn't as driver-focused or lightweight as the F1. In fact, in almost 30 years, nothing has even come close. Until now. This is the T50, and let's not mess around here because it is, on paper, utterly incredible. It's powered by a 3.9-litre naturally aspirated Cosworth V12 with 654 brake horsepower. It revs to over 12,000 RPM. It's available with a 6-speed manual gearbox only. It weighs just 986 kilograms, and there's a ground effect fan on the back in order to create more downforce. Pricing is £2.36 million before taxes, and just 100 will be made. I wasn't born when the McLaren F1 was launched, so I've never seen a press release like the one that goes with this car. And usually when there's something that comes even close, it's from a very low-volume custom car maker that can't really back up the big claims they put down on paper. Thing is, though, I reckon the T50 will be different because it's made by Gordon Murray Automotive. And that's the same chap that was responsible for the McLaren F1. And he's actually here today to show us around the car. Gordon, thank you very much for inviting us to come and see it. This is really quite thrilling, actually, because it looks amazing, as I'm sure everyone will agree. And if we can just go for kind of like a walk around the car and talk about it, that'd be really, really useful so the viewers can hear all the different points and features and engineering you've put into it. I think the first place to start, as I'm sure you can see, is that it's not actually that big, or it's not as big as a lot of other hypercars or supercars. Do you want to tell us just a little bit about what you were thinking with the dimensions of the whole car?
Well, I think if you're going to make the ultimate driver's car, try and make the ultimate driver's car, as the F1 was in its time, that has to include size. Because for a car to be usable, a lot of these modern supercars, although they're very good cars, are just too big to use, certainly on European roads. Yeah. So I'm all about packaging. For me, packaging is car design. And this has got a footprint, same footprint as a Porsche Boxster. Wow. And yet you've got a V12, three grown-ups, and decent luggage in the car as well. So, but that was part of the focus on being a pure driver's car. So the thing is usable, you know, on the road. So it's not just size, it's things like visibility, placing the car on the road, being able to place the car equally. And the central driving position, of course, is a big part of that as well, be able to place the car accurately on the road.
And also the headlamps that you can see here. Now, I understand that that little gold bit, which you'll be able to see in there in a cutaway, that's the heat sink which you've integrated into the design. I've never seen that before.
Yeah, well, most people put that, these are the next generation LEDs and they generate a lot of heat.
Yeah.
So they do need cooling. So these little slots front and rear, there's a fan recirculating the air. Wow. And you need a heat sink to dissipate the heat generated by the lamp unit. Most people put that in the return air underneath. But, you know, this car's also about a work of art, an engineering art, as the F1 was in its time. And so I thought, it's a cool looking thing, why not integrate it into the design? We had great fun doing the headlamps with a British company called YPAC.
Okay.
And that was, a big part of it, improving the performance of the lamps. This is the best spread and throw of any supercar so far.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, as you said, that's again important for usability, because going with a candle in a jam jar down a country road, that's not really what you want. I think if we move it all around towards the side of the car, let's talk about the wheels and the tires, because you can't quite see from there, but they're Michelin Pilot Sport 4s, which isn't your usual tire choice on
a supercar or a hypercar, and they're a little bit, well, quite a bit smaller than you'd usually get as well. So what was the thinking behind that?
Well, the size comes directly from the weight of the car. Mm. At 980 kilos, we just don't need big tires. So we're 235 width on the front and 295 on the rear, and that's all we need. I like working with Michelin. I go back a long time. I think they're the most technical tire company. And that's a fantastic all-round tire. This car is not about chasing numbers. So, you know, most people will put a much softer tire on to get a slightly better 0-60 or 0-100. We know this is going to be quick, this motor car. It's got a better pound-to-weight ratio than a McLaren P1 GTR and a LaFerrari, so it's not going to be slow.
No.
So, you know, it's better to fit something that's more sensible for everyday use. And that's a really good tire. You know, we're not chasing ultimate numbers here. We're chasing the ultimate driving experience.
Mm. We've got the central driving position and the two seats either side, so you can have three people in there. But what I really like, especially, is the manual gearbox, because you just don't see that anymore on a supercar with this much power with a V12 engine. That doesn't happen anymore.
No, I think
fantastic.
That's the reason why I was insistent that we only make 100 cars. Yeah. I think if you're going to try and build the ultimate driver's car, which is what we're doing, it has to be everything. Mm. You know, the engine for me is more than 50% of the car anyway. It has to be. It was never going to be anything but NA and V12. Mm. And part of that is the gear change. You know, my everyday car is a fantastic little car. It's an Alpine A110.
Yeah.
It's a brilliant little car, but the gear change is a complete non-event. You know, and that's a big part of it for me. I think if you were making 1,000 cars, you couldn't do that. But as we're only making 100, we can be a bit bullish about doing a manual box.
No, absolutely. And I'm pleased you mentioned the Alpine A110, actually, because we'll just segue away from the interior for a second. And I read that you benchmark some of this car's handling around the Alpine. Is that correct?
Yes, we did. I don't do cars that are over stiff.
Yeah.
And once again, if the car's light and the center of gravity is low, you don't need to get tricked with the suspension. You don't need to have adaptive damping and stuff. And the Alpine's a great example of getting the basics right. Mm. We ripped it, my boys in the workshop ripped my car apart for 2 months. And we measured everything. And the thing is, just got the basics right. You know, it's very light. It's very torsionally and rigid. Yeah. And in bending as well, it's very good. The local suspension stiffness on attachment points is very good.
Yeah.
The geometry, it's double wishbone, classic double wishbone, but very good geometry front and rear. Mm. Excellent compliance for a sports car, for comfort. So the secondary ride's very good. And it doesn't need adaptive damping. It doesn't need hydraulic suspension and all that stuff. And this is the same. You know, it's absolutely the same. You get into that horrible spiral. We reckon the average weight of a supercar now is over 1,400 kilos.
Yeah.
And once you get over 1.5 tons, you start having to use quite complex system to try and disguise the weight, roll compensation and all that sort of stuff, you know. And that escalates again, that gets heavier again. And before you know where you are, you've ended up with 1.6 or 1.7 tons.
Yeah.
So you just don't need it if you get the fundamentals right. Mm. So the Alpine for me was a good starting point.
The engine, which is just coming into shot here, you'll be able to see it on a cutaway again. As you said, it's a V12 3.9 litre, naturally aspirated, totally bespoke, built Cosworth. It's unlike anything I think we've seen in the last, it's unlike anything we've ever seen, actually. This is probably going to be the best V12 of all time.
It is. I mean, that I can say categorically, it is the best V12 ever designed and built. And it's difficult. You can never say never, but it's likely to be the last one. Because now that we know how much it costs to build one from scratch for just 100 cars, which is why the price point of the car is where it is, of course. But it's unlikely, as everybody is focusing on hybridization and electric motor cars, that anybody else is going to do an NA V12. And the existing NA V12s around, they've been around for decades.
Sure.
You know, the only other new one was the Valkyrie.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And there's no, it's a completely separate engine from that, isn't it?
It owes nothing. Background technology, of course.
Yeah.
But it's actually like the next generation.
Again, if we come around towards the back, you can see that all the lines on this car are all very clean. There's no massive ducts, there's no massive wings anywhere, which again is kind of going against what you usually see. And that's because it's got this ground effect fan on the back, which channels air underneath and reduces the need to have anything to obscure on the top. Is that about right?
It is. It's perfectly right. Yeah, it's rather ironic that the rear end is very technical. There's no room for paint on the rear end.
Yeah.
And but that being that technical allows us to keep the rest of the car really, really clean, because the fan works on the first part of the diffuser, which starts just behind the bulkhead here, which means that the downforce it creates is actually all around here, which is the center pressure of the, and the center gravity of the car. So that stops us needing big splitters and huge holes and ducts on the front of the car, and wings and things on the back. You know, we've got spoilers that interact with the fan, but they're just two tiny body surfaces on the trailing edge. That's been the enabler. But my mission was to do something once again with pure balance.
Yeah.
And we call it a return to beauty, because I just don't like the current trend in supercars. There seems to be a race between the OEMs to make something more dramatic rather than pretty. And the problem with that is it doesn't last. You know, if you look at an F1 today, okay, it's not modern anymore, but it still looks balanced and in proportion. You know, and that's what we were trying to do. And there were several things on the shape of the F1 I never really liked. And every time I see one, I cringe a little bit. But we just, the way we built the F1, signing it off in a clay model, it was too late to change.
Yeah.
Today's technology is, I love it. You know, I really embraced it with the early beautiful renderings you can get, VR goggles. You can walk around the car at a very early stage. We can cut a quick, a one-week full-size foam model to check proportions. None of that was available when we did the F1.
No.
And there's not a surface on this car that I don't like. You know, we've actually perfected. I've got a lot more muscle and flow and shape into it, which complements the aerodynamics as well.
Yeah, I think if you speak to any car designer, that's really rare now, that they will be 100% satisfied, because, like you said, there's, you know, it's a small company, you can be agile, and you don't have to satisfy lots of other different departments that want this bit, that done like that.
Absolutely. I would go further than that. I would say it's virtually impossible to create what could become an iconic car when you've got committees. There's too many people involved. You know, I've got a fantastic team of people. I think the best team I've ever worked with on any project at Automotive at the moment. And you know, there was a single vision, and these people have made it happen.
Yeah, no, absolutely, absolutely. And I think if you can see this panel here, which is just right in between us, this is actually where the luggage space is. So those open up kind of like that, like butterfly wings. So you can put your luggage in there. There's also a specially ordered suitcase that can fit in one of the passenger seats. So I think I was told that adds up to about 300 litres, roughly.
It's just under 300 litres of stowage space, which for a supercar is pretty good.
Yeah, I mean, for a super mini, that's pretty good, which is supposed to
take. And 30 litres of that is cabin stowage.
Yeah.
Which is as good as a lot of SUVs these days.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. No, that does make it certainly more usable. I want to just point out this as well, which I love, is these little vents that lead into the lights, because you said they run really hot, and obviously we've got the heat duct at the front. But yeah, they feed the air into the rear lights, so they don't overheat.
There's a heat sink on the back. Yeah.
That's fantastic. Yeah. It's such a nice little detail that you can see there. But yeah, as you said, coming around to the back of the car, there's no room for paint, and you weren't wrong. I mean, the car's silver, but you wouldn't know it from behind. There's the fan which dominates, but then there's the active aero underneath. And there's six aero modes on this car. Aero modes, and there's one which is a test mode, I've been told, and it's basically to show off.
Yeah, I did it. Well, it's a show-off mode, but it's also a safety mode. So before you go on a fast drive, if you want to make sure all the aero's working, all the functions scroll through their positions, and then it goes back to rest again at the end. So I had it on the F1 because we were the first people to have active aero on the rear of the car. Of course, very common now. And I had a little test mode, so you could just either show your mates how it worked, or you could check it was working before you left for your trip. The diffusers are huge, And we can only get away with that because of the fan. You know, the air, they are so vicious, the way they step up behind the rear bulkhead, the air would not normally follow those. And it doesn't, in fact, until you turn the fan on.
Yeah.
We remove all the dirty air, the boundary layer, and force the air to follow that shape. But they really are huge. I mean, they go above the drive shaft.
I want to point out the exhaust, because again, on a lot of supercars, there's four, or there's eight, or there's one giant one. These are quite modest items, and that strikes me, that's all you really need.
That's
in reality.
All we need. There's nothing. This is what I call an honest car, as the F1 was. Yeah. There's nothing on this car that's for marketing, if you like. It's all functional. Mm. Same as the lights. You know, I don't subscribe just because you can with LEDs do these melted.
Yeah,
fruit
scrolling,
types
yeah.
of things, and you know, which are out of date in 5 years' time. I don't subscribe to that. If something's going to be a light, it's got to be simple and mechanical and fit with the style of the car. The people that have bought it are the sort of people that are going to use it, and those people tend to keep it like the F1, tend to keep it in the family for a long time.
Mm.
So you don't want, they're not the sort of people that will buy this, drive it for 6 months, dump it in a collection, and buy the next best thing, because. Yeah. Nobody, I don't think anybody's going to get close to this. Trying to make this 15 years ago would have been complete nonsense, because first of all, nobody had really caught the F1 up 15 years ago. And secondly, the technology advance, particularly for that bit over there, was not, you know, it would have been a slightly better F1, which is pointless.
Yeah.
Because the F1 still drives pretty well.
Yeah.
Now, with the technology we have, both for the powertrain and the chassis and the materials and the weight, now's the time to do one, you know, where you can make a big leap forward again.
Yeah, no, absolutely.
This will be night and day from the F1 experience. I mean, just in every single way.
And I'm pleased you mentioned the F1, because there are obviously similarities, and I think you can spot those all over the car. But as you said, there are key differences. And what do you think are the biggest differences in the approach and the end product from the F1?
Yeah, well, the thing, you need to really start with the thing that's the same. The target was the same. The F1, all I said with the F1, if you look at all the pre-publicity, pre-launch press, I never boasted about numbers or speed or anything. And all I said is we were trying to make the best engineered car in the world and the best driver's car. Didn't say we were. But this one, I can say we are, because we know what makes the F1 driving experience. I mean, we're perfectly placed. I've got a lot of ex-F1 people with me, and we're perfectly placed to know why the F1 was good, the whole experience, and what bits weren't good.
Yeah.
So the focus on this was to take that experience and move it up to a new level. And that is not just the engine, but the attention to detail, the positioning of the controls. When we do the interior, we'll have a look at the interior and show you that... how much more driver focused this is. So we're just taking the whole experience. The easy thing with the F1 is to say, well, of course it's a good driving experience, central driving position, lightweight car, NA V12.
Yeah.
But actually it's a lot more than that. It's the subconscious stuff. If you jump back in an F1 and drive it, you get a smile on your face, you know. It's the PlayStation low scuttle, you know, some 100, 150 mil lower than most other supercars. Seeing the road just 2 meters in front of the car, the sitting in the center, the vision that gives you, the sort of touch and feel of the controls and the tactile stuff and the engineering art that you're surrounded with. It's a lot of little things. So what we've done is we've taken all the good stuff and we just raised the game using modern technology and materials and a great design team of people who understand that vision. Then the things that didn't work on the F1, and they fall into various categories. One was styling, which we've already talked about, with the bits I didn't like. The second one was practicality. So there were things on the F1 that were rubbish. The headlamps, for example, were just useless. The aircon didn't work. Loading the luggage in the side was dreadful. It didn't have enough interior stowage. It needed a bit more cabin space. So we've taken all those things and we just made them better. So this has got a much bigger cabin, longer, wider, flat floor, no beams past the driver. Passengers got a bit more width. The luggage, as you mentioned, loads on the top. And the aircon works because we've got a 48-volt generator on the front of the crankshaft. Yep. So that's going to work at all speeds.
Yeah.
And the headlamps don't come from Halfords this time. So it's all going to be a lot better. And then the third element was maintenance, where as good as it was, it was a fairly simple motor car, the F1, no hybridization, all that rubbish, but there were still things that really upset customers. One was you had to adjust the clutch every 5,000 or 8,000 miles, the carbon clutch. This is a fit for life. The bag tank needed changing every 5 years. This is a fit for life fuel tank. And just stuff like that, you know. So we've gone right through the motor car, not just to make the driving experience better, but more importantly, to make the whole ownership experience better.
Yeah.
It's the full package. We haven't just gone, we'll make it quicker.
Yeah.
Or we'll make it prettier. You know, it's really, as I say, we're perfectly placed to make the whole envelope better. Mm. So if you buy an F1 and keep it and use it, everything gets better. Buy a T50 over an F1, I mean.
So now we've got both the doors open and we can finally see into this incredible interior, and the driving position is just like it was on the McLaren F1, but I understand, again, it's something that you've improved and worked on and made even better.
Yeah, we spent a long time. We did three lots of seating bucks to improve ingress, egress. It'll never be as easy as a two-seater to get in,
yeah,
but it is a bit easier. And we've also made the cabin a little bit bigger. So it's a bit longer. We've given the passengers a little bit more width. We've got three times the interior stowage that we had in the F1. And quite importantly, we offer this glazed roof panel as a no-cost option. And that makes the cabin quite light and airy, less claustrophobic, if you like. It's an option because each side weighs 2.2 kilos. So if somebody doesn't want 4 kilos on the car, they can have a carbon roof, which is standard.
Well, that makes sense. Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. And I like the way as well, because of the contrasting colors. If you look straight ahead at the front of the car, it looks like it's only got one seat because it's so driver focused, and these kind of blend in.
That's the principle. That's exactly the design principle that we wanted. So it's this car is all about the owner, actually. The fact that you can take passengers quite comfortably is a sort of a secondary benefit.
Yeah.
This must be all about the owner and the driving experience. So everything, all the controls are incredibly driver-centric, even to a new level, comparing it with the F1, for example.
No, certainly. And I think we can just see the paddles on the back of the steering wheel, which obviously, you know, stood out immediately because this is a manual. So can you explain what those paddles actually
do? Yeah, so the steering wheel, I'm not a fan of steering wheels with 20 buttons on them,
yeah,
particularly when you're driving quickly. I'm also not a fan of touch screens, so there's no touch screen in sight. They're fine in a city car or something, but in a fast-moving sports car, they're a disaster. So we kept the controls on the wheel to the absolute minimum. The paddles, one side is headlamp flash,
yeah,
and one side is horn. So you can get people out the way without losing your grip on the wheel. And everything, in fact, you can maintain your normal driving grip. So the indicators are a little thumb button here.
Nice.
And
yeah,
these little scroll and push to select buttons control, the right one controls the right screen, and the left controls the left screen. And the right screen is all the infotainment, everything you would expect, you know, music and sat-nav and all that stuff. And the left screen does engine information, car information, and aero. And one cool thing, we've got the top rotary switch. All the controls are beautiful aircraft quality machined aluminium with really nice clicks and haptics. And the top left-hand one controls the aero. So when the driver selects a mode, one of the external cameras doubles as a pitot tube. So we measure static pressure. And the other transducer is underneath the car. So when the driver selects a mode, there's a gauge pops up that shows you how much suction you're generating underneath the car.
That's amazing, isn't it? There's lots of little parts. I like that. There's lots of little party tricks around,
yeah,
the car, like you, where you can.
Well, the car's so different. You know, the car's so different. So why not sort of accentuate the differences? You know.
Yeah. No. Absolutely. And I think, as you said, accentuate the differences. And you just mentioned the gear selector and all the workings underneath it, which was something you covered up on the McLaren F1. But here you've left it exposed because it looks so
fantastic. Well, everything on the motor car, and I have to say, the team have been fantastic. Even things that the owners will never see is all a piece of engineering art. There's no bits of bent metal anywhere. There's no pressed aluminium or pressed steel anywhere. everything's machined from solid, or it's a forging, or a casting. And it'd be no injection molding. So as much of that as we can show, it's like the pedals. You know, when we started this, I thought, oh, we'll never make the pedals lighter than the F1, because I drew those and I did all the stress calculations. And then we had another stab at it, and I managed to get 300 grams out of the pedals. So we've looked at every single bit of the car as a piece of engineering art.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's everything looks so ergonomically perfect, from where the gear lever is to how close the pedals are to the steering wheel, which there was a fascination a few years ago of making a nice thick steering wheel, which
I can't stand those.
No, yeah. So this is nice and thin, and there's no buttons on it. As you said, everything is just geared up around the driver, and then the passengers are just kind of, they're privileged to come along for the ride almost, because they're sat further back.
That's exactly it, yeah. I've even managed to get rid of this. I'm not a great fan of column stalks, because you inevitably have to loosen your grip to reach behind the wheel. Mm. And so I've managed to get rid of those as well. So
I clocked actually the traction control switch. So it's got traction control. It'll have a version of ESP.
Yeah, you have to. These days, you have to have ESP to sell the car. But what I've done, instead of doing these wussy stages, when you switch it off, it's 100% off. So we developed the car as though it's got no traction control and ESP. So the car is perfectly balanced as designed and developed by the development team. And then we add the ESP. A lot of manufacturers these days rely on the ESP to make the car stable.
Yes.
We don't do that. We've never done that. So although we've got it, you can switch it off.
Yeah. Even from this brief first look, it's clear that the T50 is going to be an engineering masterpiece. But what's really incredible is that all the tech and all the brilliance that's gone into it has been done with analog principles. It's not just a supercomputer on four wheels. It's not just technology for the sake of technology. It's something far more special than that, something that's never likely to be repeated. This is Concorde Mk2.